Very confident that we can bring real change.
Things work better when we work as a team. That's what Hillary Clinton believes.
And when we elect Donald Trump, they will have a team and a partner in the White House to march back up to a stronger and greater America.
Good evening, I'm Gwen Ifill.
And I'm Judy Woodruff. Welcome to this PBS NewsHour special, coverage of the one vice presidential debate between Republican Mike Pence and Democrat Tim Kaine. The stage is set at Longwood University in Farmville, Virginia. While the level of anticipation pales in comparison to last week's showdown between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump, there is still a lot on the line, Gwen.
There is, Judy. It's a chance for these two men to introduce themselves to the nation, but more important, to bolster the top of their respective tickets. Elaine Quijano of CBS News and their digital channel, CBSN, will moderate. And joining us at the table are our regular contributors, syndicated columnist Mark Shields, from the Cook Political Report, Amy Walter, and Washington Post columnist Michael Gerson. Welcome all. Here's the question of the night. Why does the vice presidential debate matter, Michael Gerson?
Well, I think Republicans actually need some good news after a historic trouncing. And so there's a morale issue here, and they need a good night.
Amy Walter?
I absolutely agree. They have the role of playing stabilizer. For Mike Pence, it is to get Trump and the Trump campaign back on track, to sort of stabilize after the big fall of this past week. And for Tim Kaine, it's to stabilize Hillary Clinton's lead. She has the momentum. She's looking strong right now. But can he help her withstand what I think for Mike Pence is going to be a much more focused and much more policy-oriented critique of the Clinton campaign?
Mark, who are the stakes higher for?
Stakes are obviously higher for Pence and for Trump because he's trying to stop the bleeding. He's trying to right the ship from listing or whatever bad metaphor you want to use or I want to use. They've had a terrible week, just a terrible week, and totally self-inflicted. And so it's Mike Pence to draw a sense of rationality, of purpose, and to be a character witness. I mean, it's fascinating because Todd Purdom in the Politico called this the battle of the normals. I mean, Mike Kaine and Mike Pence are very normal people.
And Michael Gerson, that means that there's some people are going to be watching to say, what is going to make news tonight? Just a couple of seconds.
Well, these are normal people that will have to discover their inner attack dog. This is the role of a vice presidential candidate, to press the case against the opposition. Both of them need to do that.
All right. And now we go to Farmville, Virginia. Here is Elaine Quijano of CBS News. She's the moderator of tonight's debate. She'll
Good
introduce
evening.
The two
From
candidates.
Longwood University in Farmville, Virginia. And welcome to the first and only vice presidential debate of 2016, sponsored by the Commission on Presidential Debates. I'm Elaine Quijano, anchor at CBSN and correspondent for CBS News. It's an honor to moderate this debate between Senator Tim Kaine and Governor Mike Pence. Both are longtime public servants who are also proud fathers of sons serving in the U.S. Marines. The campaigns have agreed to the rules of this 90-minute debate. There will be 9 different segments covering domestic and foreign policy issues. Each segment will begin with a question to both candidates, who will each have 2 minutes to answer. Then I'll ask follow-up questions to facilitate a discussion between the candidates. By coin toss, it's been determined that Senator Kaine will be first to answer the opening question. We have an enthusiastic audience tonight. They've agreed to only express that enthusiasm once at the end of the debate and right now, as we welcome Governor Mike Pence and Senator Tim Kaine. Gentlemen, welcome. It truly is a privilege to be with both of you tonight. I'd like to start with the topic of presidential leadership. 28 years ago, tomorrow night, Lloyd Benson said the vice presidential debate was not about the qualifications for the vice presidency, but about how, if tragedy should occur, the vice president has to step in without any margin for error, without time for preparation, to take over the responsibility for the biggest job in the world. What about your qualities, your skills, and your temperament equip you to step into that role at a moment's notice? Senator Kaine.
Elaine, thank you for being here tonight. Governor Pence, welcome. It is so great to be back at Longwood University in Farmville, Virginia. This is a very special place. 65 years ago, a young, courageous woman, Barbara Johns, led a walkout of her high school, Moton High School. She made history by protesting school segregation. She believed our nation was stronger together, and that walkout led to the Brown versus Board of Education decision that moved us down the path toward equality. I am so proud to be running with another strong, history-making woman, Hillary Clinton, to be President of the United States. I'm proud because her vision of stronger together, building an economy that works for all, not just those at the top, being safe in the world, not only with a strong military, but also strong alliances to battle terrorism and climate change, and also to build a community of respect, just like Barbara Johns tried to do 65 years ago. That's why I'm so proud to be her running mate. Hillary told me why she asked me to be her running mate. She said, the test of a Clinton administration will not be the signing of a bill or the passage of a bill. It'll be whether we can make somebody's life better, whether we can make a classroom better learning environment for school kids or teachers, whether we can make us safer. It's going to be about results. And she said to me, you've been a missionary and a civil rights lawyer. You've been a city councilman and mayor. You've been a lieutenant governor and governor, and now a U.S. senator. I think you will help me figure out how to govern this nation so that we always keep in mind that the success of the administration is the difference we make in people's lives. And that's what I bring to the ticket, that experience having served at all levels of government. But my primary role is to be Hillary Clinton's right-hand person and strong supporter as she puts together the most historic administration possible. And I relish that role. I'm so proud of her. I'll just say this. We trust Hillary Clinton, my wife and I, and we trust her with the most important thing in our life. We have a son deployed overseas in the Marine Corps right now. We trust Hillary Clinton as president and commander-in-chief, but the thought of Donald Trump as commander-in-chief scares us to death.
Governor Pence.
Well, first off, thank you, Elaine, and thank you to Norwood University for their wonderful hospitality. The Commission on Presidential Debates is deeply humbling for me to be here, be surrounded by my wonderful family. And Senator Kaine, it's an honor to be here with you as well. And I also want to say thanks to everyone that's looking in tonight, who understands what an enormously important time this is in the life of our nation. For the last 7.5 years, we've seen America's place in the world weakened. We've seen an economy stifled by more taxes, more regulation, a war on coal, and a failing health care reform come to be known as Obamacare. And the American people know that we need to make a change. And so I want to thank all of you for being with us tonight. I also want to thank Donald Trump for making that call and inviting us to be a part of this ticket. I have to tell you, I'm a small town boy from a place not too different from Farmville. I grew up with a cornfield in my backyard. My grandfather had immigrated to this country when he was about my son's age. My mom and dad built everything that matters in a small town in southern Indiana. They built a family and a good name and a business, and they raised a family. And I dreamed someday of representing my hometown in Washington, D.C., but honestly, Elaine, I never imagined I'd have the opportunity to be governor of the state that I love, let alone be sitting at a table like this in this kind of a position. So to answer your question, I would say I would hope that if the responsibility ever fell to me in this role, that I would meet it with the way that I'm going to meet the responsibility should I be elected vice president of the United States. And that's to bring a lifetime of experience, a lifetime growing up in a small town, a lifetime where I've served in the Congress of the United States, where I've led a state that works in the great state of Indiana. And whatever other responsibilities might follow from this, I would hope and, frankly, I would pray to be able to meet that moment with that lifetime of experience.
Senator Kaine, on the campaign trail, you praised Secretary Clinton's character, including her commitment to public service. Yet 60% of voters don't think she's trustworthy. Why do so many people distrust her? Is it because they have questions about her emails and the Clinton Foundation?
Elaine, let me tell you why I trust Hillary Clinton. Here's what people should look at as they look at a public servant. Do they have a passion in their life that showed up before they were in public life? And have they held on to that passion throughout their life, regardless of whether they were in office or not, succeeding or failing? Hillary Clinton has that passion. From a time as a kid in a Methodist youth group in the suburbs of Chicago, she has been focused on serving others with a special focus on empowering families and kids. As a civil rights lawyer in the South with the Children's Defense Fund, First Lady of Arkansas and this country, Senator, Secretary of State, it's always been about putting others first. And that's a sharp contrast with Donald Trump. Donald Trump always puts himself first. He built a business career in the words of one of his own campaign staffers, off the backs of the little guy. And as a candidate, he started his campaign with a speech where he called Mexicans rapists and criminals, and he has pursued the discredited and really outrageous lie that President Obama wasn't born in the United States. It is so painful to suggest that we go back to think about these days where an African American could not be a citizen of the United States. And I can't imagine how Governor Pence can defend the insult-driven, selfish, me-first style of Donald Trump.
Governor Pence, let me ask you. You have said Donald Trump is, quote, thoughtful, compassionate, and steady. Yet 67% of voters feel he is a risky choice, and 65% feel he does not have the right kind of temperament to be president. Why do so many Americans think Mr. Trump is simply too erratic?
Well, let me say first and foremost that, Senator, you and Hillary Clinton would know a lot about an insult-driven campaign. It really is remarkable. At a time when literally, in the wake of Hillary Clinton's tenure as Secretary of State, where she was the architect of the Obama administration's foreign policy, we see entire portions of the world, particularly the wider Middle East, literally spinning out of control. I mean, the situation we're watching hour by hour in Syria today is a result of the failed foreign policy and the weak foreign policy that Hillary Clinton helped lead in this administration and create. The newly emboldened the aggression of Russia, whether it was in Ukraine or now their heavy-handed approach.
You both have said Vladimir Putin is a better
president. We're going to get to Russia in just a moment, but I do want to get back to the question.
But in the midst, yeah, Elaine, thank you, Senator.
These guys have praised Vladimir Putin as a great leader. How can they defend that?
Yes, we will get to that, Senator. We do have that coming up here. But in the meantime, the questions were about your running mates.
I must have hit a nerve here.
Why the disconnect?
At a time of great challenge in the life of this nation, where we've weakened America's place in the world, stifled America's economy, the campaign of Hillary Clinton and Tim Kaine has been an avalanche of insults. Look, to get to your question about trustworthiness, Donald Trump has built a business through hard times and through good times. He's brought an extraordinary business acumen. He's employed tens of thousands of people in this country.
And paid a few taxes and lost $1 billion a year.
But why the disconnect with your running mates?
But there's a reason why people question the trustworthiness of Hillary Clinton, and that's because they're paying attention. I mean, the reality is when she was Secretary of State, Senator, come on. She had a Clinton Foundation accepting contributions from foreign governments.
You are Donald Trump's apprentice. Let me talk about this
Senator,
issue.
Senator, I think
state
I'm still
world.
On my time.
Well, I think isn't this a discussion?
This is our open discussion.
Senator, let's talk about this. Well, the state
let
of
me
the world.
Governor, let me interrupt you. Let me interrupt you and finish my sentence if I can.
Finish
the Clinton Foundation accepted foreign contributions from foreign governments and foreign donors while she was Secretary
okay,
of State.
Okay, now I can weigh
she had a private
now,
no, server
I get to weigh in
that
now.
Was
Let me
discovered
just say
this. I did raise.
To
Senator,
keep that pay-to-play
please,
process
you have an opportunity Gov- to
Governor
out
Pence,
of the reach of the
Governor
public.
Pence doesn't think the world's going so well, and he, you know, is going to say it's everybody's
do
fault.
Do you?
Let me tell you this. When Hillary Clinton became Secretary of State, Governor Pence, do you know that Osama bin Laden was alive?
Yes.
Do you know that we had 175,000 troops deployed in the battlefield in Iraq and Afghanistan? Do you know that Iran was racing toward a nuclear weapon and Russia was expanding its stockpile? Under Secretary Clinton's leadership, she was part of the national team, public safety team, that went after and revived the dormant hunt against bin Laden and wiped him off the face of the earth. She worked a deal with the Russians to reduce their chemical weapons stockpile. She worked a tough negotiation with nations around the world to eliminate the Iranian nuclear weapons program without firing a shot.
Eliminate the Iranian nuclear weapons program.
Absolutely, without firing a shot. And instead of 175,000 American troops deployed overseas, we now have 15,000.
Right. And
these are very, very
important things. And Iraq has been overrun by ISIS. Because Hillary Clinton failed to renegotiate.
More American troops in Iraq, you can propose that.
Hillary Clinton failed to renegotiate a status of forces agreement.
No, that is incorrect.
And so we removed all of our troops from Iraq, and ISIS was able to be conjured up in that vacuum and overrun vast areas of Iraq.
President Bush said we would leave Iraq at the end of 2011. And Elaine, Iraq didn't want our troops to stay, and they wouldn't give us the protection for our troops. And guess what? If a nation where our troops are serving does not want us to stay, we're not going
to
stay without them being protected.
It was a failure of the Secretary of State.
If Governor Pence wants to put more troops back in Iraq,
that's fine. There are a lot of people wondering in this country about the economy.
Right.
Let's turn to the issue of the economy. According to the Nonpartisan Committee for a Responsible Federal Budget, neither of your economic plans will reduce the growing $19 trillion gross national debt. In fact, your plans would add even more to it. Both of you were governors who balanced state budgets. Are you concerned that adding more to the debt could be disastrous for the country? Governor Pence.
I think the fact that that under this past administration, of which Hillary Clinton was a part, we've almost doubled the national debt is atrocious. I mean, I'm very proud of the fact that I come from a state that works. The state of Indiana has balanced budgets. We cut taxes. We made record investments in education and in infrastructure. And I still finished my term with $2 billion in the bank. That's a little bit different than when Senator Kaine was governor here in Virginia. He actually tried to raise taxes by about $4 billion. He left his state about $2 billion in the hole. The state of Indiana, we've cut unemployment in half, unemployment doubled when he was governor. But I think he's a very fitting running mate for Hillary Clinton. Because in the wake of a season where American families are struggling in this economy, under the weight of higher taxes and Obamacare and the war on coal and the stifling avalanche of regulation coming out of this administration, Hillary Clinton and Tim Kaine want more of the same. It really is remarkable that they actually are advocating $1 trillion in tax increases, which I get that. You tried to raise taxes here in Virginia and were unsuccessful. But $1 trillion in tax increases, more regulation, more of the same war on coal, and more of Obamacare that now even former President Bill Clinton calls Obamacare a crazy plan. But Hillary Clinton and Tim Kaine want to build on Obamacare. They want to expand it into a single-payer program. And for all the world, Hillary Clinton just thinks Obamacare is a good start. Look, Donald Trump and I have a plan to get this economy moving again, just the way that it worked in the 1980s, just the way it worked in the 1960s. And that is by lowering taxes across the board for working families, small businesses, and family farms, ending the war on coal. It is hurting jobs and hurting this economy, even here in Virginia. Repealing Obamacare, lock, stock, and barrel, and repealing all of the executive orders that Barack Obama has signed that are stifling economic growth in this economy. We can get America moving again, put on top of that the kind of trade deals that'll put the American worker first, and you've got a prescription for real growth. And when you get the economy growing, Elaine, that's when you can deal with the national debt. When we get back to 3.5% to 4% growth with Donald Trump's plan, we'll do. Then we're going to have the resources to meet our nation's needs at home and abroad, and we're going to have the ability to bring down the national debt.
Senator Kaine.
Elaine, on the economy, there's a fundamental choice for the American electorate. Do you want a your hired president in Hillary Clinton, or do you want a your fired president in Donald Trump? I think that's not such a hard choice. Hillary and I have a plan that's on the table that's a your hired plan. Five components. First thing we do is we invest in manufacturing infrastructure and research in the clean energy jobs of tomorrow. Second thing is we invest in our workforce, from pre-K education to great teachers to debt-free college and tuition-free college for families that make less than $125,000 a year. Third, we promote fairness by raising the minimum wage so you can't work full-time and be under the poverty level, and by paying women equal pay for equal work. Fourth, we promote small business growth, just as we've done in Virginia. To make it easier to start and grow small businesses, Hillary and I each grew up in small business families. My dad, who ran an iron working and welding shop, is here tonight. And fifth, we have a tax plan that targets tax relief to middle-class individuals and small businesses. and ask those at the very top who've benefited as we've come out of recession to pay more. The Trump plan is a different plan. It's a you're fired plan, and there's two key elements to it. First, Donald Trump said wages are too high, and both Donald Trump and Mike Pence think we ought to eliminate the federal minimum wage. Mike Pence, when he was in Congress, voted against raising the minimum wage above $5.15, and he has been a one-man bulwark against minimum wage increases in Indiana. The second component of the plan is massive tax breaks for the very top, trillions of dollars of tax breaks for people just like Donald Trump. The problem with this, Elaine, is that's exactly what we did 10 years ago, and it put the economy into the deepest recession since the 1930s. Independent analysts say the Clinton plan would grow the economy by 10.5 million jobs. The Trump plan would cost 3.5 million jobs. And Donald Trump, why would he do this? Because his tax plan basically helps him. And if he ever met his promise and he gave his tax returns to the American public like he said he would, we would see just how much his economic plan is really a Trump first plan.
On that point, Governor Pence, recently the New York Times released part of Mr. Trump's 1995 tax return and reported that he could have avoided paying federal income taxes for years. Yesterday, Mr. Trump said he brilliantly used the laws to pay as little tax as legally possible. Does that seem fair to you?
Well, first, let me say I appreciated the you're hired, you're fired thing, Senator. You used that a whole lot, and I think your running mate used a lot of pre-done lines. Look, what you all just heard out there is more taxes, $2 trillion in more spending, more deficits, more debt, more government. And if you think that's all working, then you look at the other side of the table. I mean, the truth of the matter is the policies of this administration, which Hillary Clinton and Senator Kaine want to continue, have run this economy into a ditch. We're in the slowest economic recovery since the Great Depression.
15
Governor,
million new
there are millions more people living in poverty today than the day that Barack Obama, with Hillary Clinton at his side,
and the poverty
stepped
level
into the Oval
and the
Office.
Median income
we the lowest
improved
level.
Dramatically
you
can, look, between you, 2014 and 2015.
Honestly, Senator, you can roll out the numbers and the sunny side, but I got to tell you, people in Scranton, no different. People in Fort Wayne, Indiana, no different. I mean, this economy is struggling. And the answer to this economy is not more taxes.
But it's not to give away tax relief to the folks at the top.
And so I
am interested to hearing whether he'll defend his running mates not releasing taxes and not paying taxes.
Absolutely, I will.
Governor, with all due respect, the question was about whether it seems fair to you that Mr. Trump said he brilliantly used the laws to pay as little tax as legally possible.
Well, this is probably the difference between Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton and Senator Kaine. I mean, Hillary Clinton and Senator Kaine, and God bless you for it, career public servants, that's great. Donald Trump is a businessman, not a career politician. He actually built a business. Those tax returns that came out publicly this week showed that he faced some pretty tough times 20 years ago. But like virtually every other business, including the New York Times not too long ago, he used what's called net operating loss. We have a tax code, Senator, that actually is designed to encourage entrepreneurship.
But why won't
country.
He release his tax returns?
Well, we're answering the question about the business thing. His tax returns that showed he went through a very difficult time, but he used the tax code just the way it's supposed to be used, and he did it brilliantly.
How do you know
he
that?
Created
you haven't seen
a runway because he's created a business that's worth billions of dollars today.
How do you know that?
And with regard to paying taxes, this whole riff about not paying taxes and people saying he didn't pay taxes for years. Donald Trump has created tens of thousands of jobs, and he's paid payroll taxes, sales taxes.
Senator, I'm going to give you about 30
taxes.
Seconds to respond, and I have a question on
Hillary
Social Security.
Clinton is going to raise taxes, and
Governor,
Donald Trump and I are going to cut them.
Donald Trump started this campaign in 2014. He said, if I run for president, I will absolutely release my taxes. He's broken his first promise. Second, he stood on the stage last week, and when Hillary said you haven't been paying taxes, he said, that makes me smart. So it's smart not to pay for our military. It's smart not to pay for veterans. It's smart not to pay for teachers. And I guess all of us who do pay for those things, I guess we're stupid. And the last thing I'll say,
Senator,
is this.
Senator, do you take all the deductions that you're entitled to?
The last thing I want to ask Governor Pence is
I do.
This. Governor Pence had to give Donald Trump his tax returns to show he was qualified to be vice president. Donald Trump must give the American public his tax returns to show that he's qualified to be president, and he's breaking his promise.
Elaine, I have to respond to this.
You get very little time, 20 seconds.
I'll be very respectful.
Governor.
Look, Donald Trump has filed over 100 pages of financial disclosure, which is what the law requires.
But he said he
and
would
the
release his tax
returns.
American
people can review that, and he's going... Senator,
all right,
he's going to release his tax returns
when
the audit
Social Security.
Is over.
Richard Nixon released tax returns when
they're
he was under audit.
They're going to raise your taxes.
Gentlemen,
we're
if you
cut
can't
your
meet
taxes.
The Nixon standard,
the people at home cannot understand
some...
either one of you when you speak over each other. I would please ask you to wait until it is that the other is finished.
All right,
Senator
we're having
Kaye,
fun up here.
On the issue of Social Security, in 18 years, when the Social Security trust funds run out of money, you'll be 76. The Committee for a Responsible Federal Budget estimates your benefits could be cut by as much as $7,500 per year. What would your administration do to prevent this cut?
First, we're going to protect Social Security, which was one of the greatest programs that the American government has ever done. It happened at a time when you would work your whole life, raising your kids, working, being a little league coach or a Sunday school teacher, and then you would retire into poverty. And Social Security has enabled people to retire with dignity and overwhelmingly not be in poverty. We have to keep it solvent, and we will keep it solvent. And we'll look for strategies like adjusting the payroll tax cap upward in order to do that. Here's what Hillary and I will not do, and I want to make this very plain. We will never, ever engage in a risky scheme to privatize Social Security. Donald Trump wrote a book, and he said Social Security is a Ponzi scheme, and privatization would be good for all of us. And when Congressman Pence was in Congress, he was the chief cheerleader for the privatization of Social Security. Even after President Bush stopped pushing for it, Congressman Pence kept pushing for it. We're going to stand up against efforts to privatize Social Security, and we'll look for ways to keep it solvent going forward, focusing primarily on the payroll tax cap.
Governor Pence, I'll give you an opportunity to respond.
Well, thanks, Elaine. There they go again. Okay. All Donald Trump and I have said about Social Security is we're going to meet our obligations to our seniors. That's it.
Go read the book.
We've said we're going to meet the obligations of Medicare. That's what this campaign is really about, Senator. And I get this is the old scare tactic that
you have a voting record,
Governor. And I get all of that. I just, look, there's a question that you asked a little bit earlier
that
I have to go back to.
You won't defend your own voting record.
I have to go back to. Well, look, you're running with Hillary Clinton, who wants to raise taxes by $1 trillion, increase spending by $2 trillion. And you say you're going to keep the promises of Social Security. Donald Trump and I are going to cut taxes. We're going to reform government programs.
You're going to raise taxes
so
on the middle class.
So we can meet the obligations of Social Security and Medicare.
All right.
If we stay on the path that your party has us on, we're going to be in a mountain range of debt, and we're going to face hard choices.
Gentlemen, I want to move on now.
You did ask us a question about debt, and the debt explosion on the Trump plan is much, much bigger than anything on the Clinton side.
All right, let me move on now to the issue of law enforcement and race relations. Law enforcement and race relations. After the Dallas police shooting, Police Chief David Brown said, quote, "We're asking cops to do too much in this country. Every societal failure, we put it off on the cops to solve. Not enough mental health funding, not enough drug addiction funding. Schools fail. Let's give it to the cops." Do we ask too much of police officers in this country? And how would you specifically address the chief's concerns, Senator Kaye?
Elaine, I think that's a very fair comment. I think we put a lot on police shoulders. And this is something I got a lot of scar tissue and experience on. I was a city councilman and mayor in Richmond. And when I came in, we had one of the highest homicide rates in the United States. We fought very, very hard over the course of my time in local office with our police department, and we reduced our homicide rate nearly in half. And then when I was governor of Virginia, we worked hard, too. And we did something we had really wanted to do. For the first time ever, we cracked the top 10 safest states because we worked together. Here's what I learned as a mayor and a governor. The way you make communities safer and the way you make police safer is through community policing. You build the bonds between the community and the police force, build bonds of understanding. And then when people feel comfortable in their communities, that gap between the police and the communities they serve narrows. And when that gap narrows, it's safer for the communities and it's safer for the police. That model still works across our country, but there are some other models that don't work. An overly aggressive, more militarized model Donald Trump recently said we need to do more stop and frisk around the country. That would be a big mistake because it polarizes the relationship between the police and the community. So here's what we'll do. We'll focus on community policing. We will focus on, and Hillary Clinton has rolled out a really comprehensive mental health reform package that she worked on with law enforcement professionals. And we will also fight the scourge of gun violence in the United States. I'm a gun owner. I'm a strong Second Amendment supporter. But I got a lot of scar tissue because when I was governor of Virginia, there was a horrible shooting at Virginia Tech. And we learned that through that painful situation, that gaps in the background record check system should have been closed and it could have prevented that crime. And so we're going to work to do things like close background record checks. And if we do, we won't have the tragedies that we did. One of those killed at Virginia Tech was a guy named Liviu Librescu. He was a 70-plus-year-old Romanian Holocaust survivor. He'd survived the Holocaust. Then he survived the Soviet Union takeover of his country. But then he was a visiting professor at Virginia Tech, and he couldn't survive the scourge of gun violence. We can support the Second Amendment and do things like background record checks and make us safer, and that'll make police safer, too.
Governor Pence.
You know, my uncle was a cop, a career cop, on the beat in downtown Chicago. He was my hero when I was growing up. When we go up to visit my dad's family in Chicago, my three brothers and I would marvel at my uncle when he would come out in his uniform, sidearm at his side. Police officers are the best of us. And men and women, white, African-American, Asian, Latino, Hispanic, they put their lives on the line every single day. And let me say, at the risk of agreeing with you, community policing is a great idea. Mm-hmm. It's worked in the Hoosier State, and we fully support that. Donald Trump and I are going to make sure that law enforcement have the resources and the tools to be able to really restore law and order to the cities and communities of this nation. It's probably why the 330,000 members of the Fraternal Order of Police endorsed Donald Trump as the next president of the United States of America, because they see his commitment to them. They see his commitment to law and order. But they also hear the bad-mouthing that comes from people that seize upon tragedy in the wake of police action shootings as a reason to use a broad brush to accuse law enforcement of implicit bias or institutional racism. And that really has got to stop. I mean, when an African-American police officer in Charlotte named Brentley Vinson, an all-star football player who went to Liberty University here in the state, came home, followed his dad into law enforcement, joined the force in Charlotte in 2014, was involved in a police action shooting that claimed the life of Keith Lamont Scott. It was a tragedy. I mean, we mourn with those who mourn. We grieve with those who grieve. We're saddened at the loss of life. But Hillary Clinton actually referred to that moment as an example of implicit bias in the police force, where she used, when she was asked in the debate a week ago whether there was implicit bias in law enforcement, her only answer was that there's implicit bias in everyone in the United States.
I just think
what we ought to do is we ought to stop seizing on these moments of tragedy. We ought to assure the public that we'll have a full and complete and transparent investigation whenever there's a loss of life because of police action. But Senator, please, you know, enough of this seeking every opportunity to demean law enforcement broadly by making the accusation of implicit bias every time tragedy occurs.
Elaine, people shouldn't be afraid to bring up issues of bias in law enforcement. And if you're afraid to have if you're afraid to have the discussion, you'll never solve it. And so here's an example, heartbreaking. We would agree this is a heartbreaking example. The guy, Philando Castile, who was killed in St. Paul, he was a worker, a valued worker in a local school. And he was killed for no apparent reason in an incident that will be discussed and will be investigated. But when folks went and explored this situation, what they found is that Philando Castile, who was they called him Mr. Rogers with dreadlocks in the school that he worked, the kids loved him, that he had been stopped by police 40 or 50 times before that fatal incident. And if you look at sentencing in this country, African Americans and Latinos get sentenced for the same crimes at very different rates.
We need criminal justice reform. Indiana has passed criminal justice reform.
But I just want to say, those who say we should not be able to bring up and talk about bias in the system,
Senator,
will never solve the problem.
When an African-American police officer is involved in a police action shooting involving an African-American, why would Hillary Clinton accuse that African-American police officer of implicit bias?
I guess I can't believe you are defending the position that there is no bias and it's a topic.
Governor Pence, I have a question on that point. Your fellow Republican, Governor Pence, Senator Tim Scott, who is African-American, recently spoke on the Senate floor. He said he was stopped 7 times by law enforcement in 1 year.
A U.S. Senator.
He said, I have felt the anger, the frustration, the sadness, and the humiliation that comes with feeling like you're being targeted for nothing more than being just yourself. What would you say to Senator Scott about his experiences?
Well, I have the deepest respect for Senator Scott, and he's a close friend. And what I would say is that we need to adopt criminal justice reform nationally. I signed criminal justice reform in the state of Indiana, Senator, and we're very proud of it. I worked when I was in Congress on the Second Chance Act. We have got to do a better job recognizing and correcting the errors in the system that do reflect an institutional bias in criminal justice. But what Donald Trump and I are saying is, let's not have the reflex of assuming the worst of men and women in law enforcement. We truly do believe that law enforcement is not a force for racism or division in our country.
So what would you say to Senator Scott, Governor?
Law enforcement in this country is a force for good. They truly are people that put their lives on the line every single day. But I would suggest to you, what we need to do is assert a stronger leadership at the national level to support law enforcement. You just heard Senator Kaine reject a stop and frisk. Well, I would suggest to you that the families that live in our inner cities that are besieged by crime...
Governor, what would you tell Senator Scott?
If I could, Jeff, but I've heard Senator Scott make that eloquent plea. And look, criminal justice is about respecting the law and being respected by the law. So there is a fundamental respect issue here. And I just want to talk about the tone that's set from the top. Donald Trump during this campaign has called Mexicans rapists and criminals. He's called women slobs, pigs, dogs, disgusting. I don't like saying that in front of my wife and my mother. He attacked an Indiana-born federal judge and said he was unqualified to hear a federal lawsuit because his parents were Mexican. He went after John McCain, a POW, and said he wasn't a hero because he'd been captured. He said African Americans are living in hell, and he perpetrated this outrageous and bigoted lie that President Obama is not a U.S. citizen. If you want to have a society where people are respected and respect laws, you can't have somebody at the top who demeans every group that he talks about. And I just, again, I cannot believe that Governor Pence will defend the insult-driven campaign that Donald Trump has run.
All right, I want to turn to our next segment now, immigration. Your running mates have both said that undocumented immigrants who have committed violent crimes should be deported. What would you tell the millions of undocumented immigrants who have not committed violent crimes? Governor Pence.
Well, Donald Trump's laid out a plan to end illegal immigration once and for all in this country. We've been talking it to death for 20 years. Hillary Clinton and Tim Kaine want to continue the policies of open borders, amnesty, catch and release, sanctuary cities, all the things that are driving driving wages down in this country, Senator, and also too often, with criminal aliens in the country, it's bringing heartbreak. But Donald Trump has a plan that he laid out in Arizona that will deal systematically with illegal immigration, beginning with border security, internal enforcement. It's probably why, for the first time in the history of Immigrations and Customs Enforcement, their union actually endorsed Donald Trump as the next president of the United States, because they know they need help to enforce the laws of this country. And Donald Trump has laid out a priority to remove criminal aliens, remove people that have overstayed their visas. And once we have accomplished all of that, which will strengthen our economy, strengthen the rule of law in the country, and make our communities safer once the criminal aliens are out, then we'll deal with those that remain. But I have to tell you, I was listening to the avalanche of insults coming out of Senator Kaine a minute ago.
These were said, Donald.
He says,
hold on a second.
It's my
Governor.
Time, Senator.
It is. In fact,
right.
The governor's time.
I apologize. Says, this is your 2 minutes.
Thanks. I forgive you. He says ours is an insult-driven campaign. Did you all just hear that? Ours is an insult-driven campaign? I mean, to be honest with you, if Donald Trump had said all the things that you said he said in the way you said he said them, he still wouldn't have a fraction of the insults that Hillary Clinton leveled when she said that half of our supporters were a basket of deplorables. That she said they were irredeemable. They were not America. I mean, it's extraordinary. And then she laid one after another ism on millions of Americans who believe that we can have a stronger America at home and abroad, who believe we can get this economy moving again, who believe that we can end illegal immigration once and for all. So, Senator, this insult-driven campaign, I mean, that's small potatoes compared to Hillary Clinton calling half of Donald Trump's supporters a basket of deplorables.
Hillary Clinton said something on the campaign trail, and the very next day she said, you know what, I shouldn't have said that.
She said she shouldn't have said half.
Governor, this is Senator Kaine's 2 minutes, please.
Yeah, that's right. So now we're even.
Yeah.
Look for Donald Trump apologizing to John McCain for saying he wasn't a hero. Oh, did Donald Trump apologize for calling women slobs, pigs, dogs, disgusting? Did Donald Trump apologize for taking after somebody in a Twitter war and making fun of her weight? Did he apologize for saying African Americans are living in hell? Did he apologize for saying President Obama was not even a citizen of the United States? You will look in vain to see Donald Trump ever taking responsibility for anybody and apologizing. Immigration. There's two plans on the table. Hillary and I believe in comprehensive immigration reform. Donald Trump believes in deportation nation. You got to pick your choice. Hillary and I want a bipartisan reform that will put keeping families together as the top goal. Second, that will help focus enforcement efforts on those who are violent. Third, that will do more border control, and fourth, that will provide a path to citizenship for those who work hard, pay taxes, play by the rules, and take criminal background record checks. That's our proposal. Donald Trump proposes to deport 16 million people, 11 million who are here without documents, and both Donald Trump and Mike Pence want to get rid of birthright citizenship. So if you're born here, but your parents don't have documents, they want to eliminate that. That's another 4.5 million people. These guys, and Donald Trump has said it, deportation force. They want to go house to house, school to school, business to business, and kick out 16 million people. And I cannot believe that Governor Pence would sit here and defend his running mate's claim that we should create a deportation force so that they'll all be gone. So,
Senator, we have a deportation force. It's called Immigrations and Customs Enforcement. And the Union for Immigrations and Customs Enforcement, for the first time in their history, endorsed Donald Trump to be the next president of the United States.
So you like the 16 million deportation plan?
Senator, that's nonsense. Look, what you just heard is they have a plan for open borders, amnesty.
Our plan is like Ronald Reagan's plan from 1986.
They call it comprehensive immigration reform on Capitol Hill. We all know the routine. It's amnesty. And you heard one of the last things he mentioned was border security. That's how Washington always plays it.
No,
so Governor,
I always say we're going to do this, we're going to do that.
Border security 3 years ago, and Governor Pence was against it.
Governor, Mr. Trump
has said a nation without borders is not a nation. Donald Trump is committed to restoring the borders of this nation, securing our nation.
How would these millions of undocumented immigrants leave? Would they be forcibly removed?
Well, I think Donald Trump laid out a series of priorities that doesn't end with border security. It begins with border security. And after we secure the border, not only build a wall, but beneath the ground and in the air, we do internal enforcement. But he said the focus has to be on criminal aliens. We just had a conversation about law enforcement. We just had a conversation about the violence that's besetting our cities. The reality is that there's heartbreak and tragedy that has struck American families because people that came into this country illegally are now involved in criminal enterprise and activity, and we don't have the resources or the will to deport them systematically. Donald Trump has said we're going to move those people out, people who've overstayed their visas. We're going to enforce the law of this country. We're going to strengthen immigrations and customs enforcements with more resources and more personnel to be able to do that. But then Donald Trump has made it clear, once we've done all of those things, We're going to reform the immigration system that we have, where people can come into this country. That's the order that you should do it. Border security, removing criminal aliens, upholding the law, and then, Senator, I'll work with you when you go back to the Senate, I promise you. We'll work with you to reform the immigration system.
I look forward to working together in whatever capacities we serve in, but I just want to make it very, very clear that he's trying to fuzz up what Donald Trump has said. When Donald Trump spoke in Phoenix, he looked the audience in the eye, and he said, no, we're building the wall, and we're deporting everybody. He said, quote, they will all be gone. They will all be gone. And this is one of these ones where you can just go to the tape on it and see what Donald Trump has said. And to add to it, we are a nation of immigrants. Mike Pence and I both are descended from immigrant families. Some things, you know, maybe weren't said so great about the Irish when they came, but we've done well by absorbing immigrants, and it's made our nation stronger. When Donald Trump says Mexicans are rapists and criminals, Mexican immigrants, when Donald Trump says about your judge, who's your judge? He said that Judge Curiel was unqualified to hear a case because his parents were Mexican. I can't imagine how you can defend that.
Gentlemen, I'd like to shift now to the threat of terrorism. Do you think the world today is a safer or more dangerous place than it was 8 years ago? Has the terrorist threat increased or decreased? Senator Kaine.
The terrorist threat has decreased in some ways because bin Laden is dead. The terrorist threat has decreased in some ways because an Iranian nuclear weapons program has been stopped. The terrorist threat to United States troops has been decreased in some ways because there's not 175,000 in a dangerous part of the world. There's only 15,000, but there are other parts of the world that are challenging. Let me tell you this. To beat terrorism, there's only one candidate who can do it, and it's Hillary Clinton. Remember, Hillary Clinton was the senator from New York on 9/11. She was there at the World Trade Center when they were still searching for victims and survivors. That seared onto her the need to beat terrorism, and she's got a plan to do it. She was part of the national security team that wiped out bin Laden. Here's her plan to defeat ISIL. First, we got to keep taking out their leaders on the battlefield. She was part of the team that got bin Laden, and she'll lead the team that will get Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, the head of ISIS. Second, we got to disrupt financing networks. Third, disrupt their ability to recruit on the internet in their safe havens. But fourth, we also have to work with allies to share and surge intelligence. That's the Hillary Clinton plan. She's got the experience to do it. Donald Trump. Donald Trump can't start a Twitter war with Miss Universe without shooting himself in the foot. Donald Trump doesn't have a plan. He said, I have a secret plan. And then he said, I know more than all the generals about ISIL. And then he said, I'm going to call the generals to help me figure out a plan. And finally, he said, I'm going to fire all the generals. He doesn't have a plan. But he does have dangerous ideas. Here's four. He trash talks the military. The military is a disaster. John McCain's no hero. The generals need all to be fired, and I know more than them. He wants to tear up alliances. NATO is obsolete and will only work together with Israel if they pay big league. Third, he loves dictators. He's got kind of a personal Mount Rushmore. Vladimir Putin, Kim Jong-un, Muammar Gaddafi, and Saddam Hussein. And last and most dangerously, Donald Trump believes that the world will be safer if more nations have nuclear weapons. He said Saudi Arabia should get them, Japan should get them, Korea should get them. And when he was confronted with this and told, wait a minute, terrorists could get those. Proliferation could lead to nuclear war. Here's what Donald Trump said, and I quote, go ahead, folks, enjoy yourselves. I'd love to hear Governor Pence tell me what's so enjoyable or comical about nuclear war.
Governor Pence.
Did you work on that one a long time? Because that had a lot of really creative lines in it.
Well, I'm going to see if you can defend any of it.
Look, I can defend. I can make it very clear to the American people. After traveling millions of miles as our Secretary of State, after being the architect of the foreign policy of this administration, America is less safe today than it was the day that Barack Obama became President of the United States. It's absolutely inarguable. We've weakened America's place in the world. It's been a combination of factors, but mostly it's been a lack of leadership. I mean, I will give you, and I was in Washington, D.C. on 9/11. I saw the clouds of smoke rise from the Pentagon.
I was in Virginia, where the Pentagon's located.
I know you were. Mm-hmm. We all lived through that day as mm-hmm. a nation. It was heartbreaking. And I want to give this president credit for bringing Osama bin Laden to justice. But the truth is, Osama bin Laden led al-Qaeda. Our primary threat today is ISIS. And because Hillary Clinton failed to renegotiate a status of forces agreement that would have allowed some American combat troops to remain in Iraq and secure the hard-fought gains the American soldier had won by 2009, ISIS was able to be literally conjured up out of the desert, and it's overrun vast areas that the American soldier had won in Operation Iraqi Freedom. My heart breaks for the likes of Lance Corporal Scott Zubowski. He fell in Fallujah in 2005. He fought hard through some of the most difficult days in Operation Iraqi Freedom. And he paid the ultimate sacrifice to defend our freedom and secure that nation. And that nation was secured in 2009. But because Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama failed to provide a status of forces agreement and leave sufficient troops in there, we are back at war. The president just ordered more troops on the ground. We are back at war in Iraq. And Scott Zubowski, whose mom would always come to Memorial Day events in Newcastle, Indiana, to see me, and I'd always give her a hug and tell her we're never going to forget our son, and we never will. Scott Zubowski and the sacrifices the American soldier made were squandered in Iraq because this administration created a vacuum in which ISIS was able to grow. And a reference to the Iranian deal that Hillary Clinton initiated, $150 billion
stopping a nuclear weapons program without firing a shot.
You didn't stop the nuclear weapons program.
Yes, we did. You
essentially,
even the Israeli military says it stopped.
You essentially guaranteed that Iran will someday become a nuclear power because there's no limitations once the period of time of the treaty comes off.
Governor Pence, Mr. Trump has proposed extreme vetting of immigrants from parts of the world that export terrorism. But that does not address many of the recent terrorist attacks in the United States, such as the Orlando nightclub massacre and the recent bombings in New York and New Jersey. Those were homegrown, committed by U.S. citizens and legal residents. What specific tools would you use to prevent those kinds of attacks?
Well, I think it's a great question, Elaine. But it really does begin with us reforming our immigration system and putting the interests, particularly the safety and security of the American people, first. I mean, Donald Trump has called for extreme vetting for people coming in to this country so that we don't bring people into the United States who are hostile to our Bill of Rights freedoms, who are hostile to the American way of life. But also, Donald Trump and I are committed to suspending the Syrian refugee program and programs and immigration from areas of the world that have been compromised by terrorism. Hillary Clinton and Tim Kaine want to increase the Syrian refugee program by 500.
Elaine, I want to tell you about our plan.
Homegrown.
Yeah.
But first, you know, let's make sure we're putting the safety and security of the American people first instead of Hillary Clinton expanding the Syrian refugee
program. Or instead
of
you violating the Constitution by blocking people based on their national origin rather than whether they're dangerous.
That's absolutely false.
That's what the Seventh Circuit decided. Here's the difference.
The Seventh Circuit.
We have different views on refugee issues and on immigration. Hillary and I want to do enforcement based on are people dangerous. These guys say all Mexicans are bad. And with respect to refugees, we want to keep people out if they're dangerous. Donald Trump said keep them out if they're Muslim. Mike Pence put a program in place to keep them out if they're from Syria. And yesterday, an appellate court with three Republican judges struck down the Pence plan and said it was discriminatory.
And those judges,
we should focus upon danger, not upon discrimination.
Elaine, to your point, those judges said it was because there wasn't any evidence yet that ISIS had infiltrated the United States. Well, Germany just arrested three Syrian refugees
ISIS. But they told you there's a right way and a wrong way to do it.
But look, if you're going to be critical of me on that, that's fair game. I will tell you, after two Syrian refugees were involved in the attack in Paris that is called Paris's 9/11, as governor of the state of Indiana, I have no higher priority than the safety and security of the people of my state.
But Governor Pence.
So you bet I suspended that program.
But Governor Pence.
And I stand by that decision. And if I'm vice president of the United States or Donald Trump is president, we're going to put the safety and security of the American people first.
Can we just be clear? Hillary and I will do immigration enforcement and we'll vet refugees based on whether they're dangerous or not. We won't do it based on discriminating against you from the country you come from or the religion that you
practice. But the problem with that
is completely antithetical to the Jeffersonian values of equality.
Elaine, the director of the FBI or Homeland Security said, we can't know for certain who these people are coming from Syria.
Yes, we can. And when we don't let them know, we don't let them in.
So the FBI...
When we don't know who they are, we don't let them in.
The FBI and Homeland Security said, we can't know for certain. You've got to err on the side of the safety and security of the American people, Senator. I understand
by trashing all Syrians or trashing all Muslims.
Senator Kaine, let me ask you this. Secretary Clinton has talked about an intelligence surge.
Yes.
What exactly would an intelligence surge look like, and how would that help identify terrorists with no operational connection to a foreign terrorist organization?
Intelligence surge is two things, Elaine. It's two things. It's first, dramatically expanding our intelligence capacities by hiring great professionals, but also we've got some of the best intel and cyber employees in the world right here in the United States working for many of our private sector companies. So it involves increase on our own workforce, but striking great partnerships with some of our cyber and intel experts in the private sector so that we can, consistent with constitutional principles, gather more intelligence. But the second piece of this is really, really important. It also means creating stronger alliances, because you gather intelligence and then you share your intelligence back and forth with allies. And that's how you find out who may be trying to recruit, who may be trying to come from one country to the next. Alliances are critical. That's why Donald Trump's claim that he wants to, that NATO is obsolete and that we need to get rid of NATO is so dangerous.
That's not his plan.
Well, he said NATO is obsolete. And look, if you push aside your alliances, who are you going to share intelligence with? Hillary Clinton is the Secretary of State who knows how to build alliances. She built the sanctions regime around the world that stopped the Iranian nuclear weapons program, and that's what an intelligence surge means. Better skill and capacity, but also better alliances.
All right, I'd like to turn now to the tragedy in Syria.
Can I speak about the cybersecurity surge at all?
You can have 30 seconds, Governor, quickly, please.
First, Donald Trump just spoke about this issue this week. We have got to bring together the best resources of this country to understand that that cyber warfare is the new warfare of the asymmetrical enemies that we face in this country. And I look forward, if I'm privileged to be in this role, of working with you in the Senate to make sure that we resource that effort.
We will work together in whatever roles we inhabit.
We have an intelligence serve. But I will also tell you that it's important in this moment to remember that Hillary Clinton had a private server in her home that had classified information on it about drone strikes. Emails from the President of the United States of America were on there. Her private server was subject
Governor,
to being hacked by foreign
I'd like
hours.
To ask you about Syria,
we could put,
Governor.
We could put cybersecurity first if we just make sure the next Secretary of State doesn't have a private
server. A full investigation concluded that not one reasonable prosecutor would take any additional step. You don't get to decide the rights and wrongs of this. We have a justice system that does that. And a Republican FBI director did an investigation and concluded...
All right, we are moving on now.
Senator, if your son or my son handled classified information the way Hillary Clinton did, they'd be court-martialed.
That is absolutely false, and you know
that.
And you know that, Governor.
Governor.
It's absolutely true.
Because the FBI did an investigation.
Gentlemen.
And they concluded that there was no reasonable prosecutor who would take it further.
Senator Kaine, Governor Pence, please.
Syria.
I want to turn now to Syria. 250,000 people, 100,000 of them children, are under siege in Aleppo, Syria. Bunker buster bombs, cluster munitions, and incendiary weapons are being dropped on them by Russian and Syrian militaries. Does the U.S. have a responsibility to protect civilians and prevent mass casualties on this scale? Governor Pence.
The United States of America needs to begin to exercise strong leadership to protect the vulnerable citizens and over 100,000 children in Aleppo. Hillary Clinton's top priority when she became Secretary of State was the Russian reset. The Russian reset. After the Russian reset, the Russians invaded Ukraine and took over Crimea. And the small and bullying leader of Russia is now dictating terms to the United States to the point where all the United States of America, the greatest nation on earth, just withdraws from talks about a ceasefire while Vladimir Putin puts a missile defense system in Syria while he marshals the forces and begins. Look, we have got to begin to lean into this with strong broad-shouldered American leadership. It begins by rebuilding our military. I mean, the Russians and the Chinese have been making enormous investments in the military. We have the smallest Navy since 1916. We have the lowest number of troops since the end of the Second World War. We've got to work with the Congress and Donald Trump will to rebuild our military and project American strength in the world. But about Aleppo and about Syria, I truly do believe that what America ought to do right now is to immediately establish safe zones so that families and vulnerable families with children can move out of those areas, work with our Arab partners real time right now to make that happen. And secondly, I just have to tell you that the provocations by Russia need to be met with American strength. And if Russia chooses to be involved and continue, I should say, to be involved in this barbaric attack on civilians in Aleppo, the United States of America should be prepared to use military force to strike military targets of the Assad regime, to prevent them from this humanitarian crisis that is taking place in Aleppo. There's a broad range of other things that we ought to do as well. We ought to deploy a missile defense shield to the Czech Republic and Poland, which Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama pulled back on out of not wanting to offend the Russians.
Governor,
back in 2009. We've just got to have American strength on the world stage. When Donald Trump becomes president of the United States, the Russians and other countries in the world will know they're dealing with a strong American president.
Senator
Hillary and I also agree that the establishment of a humanitarian zone in northern Syria, with the provision of international human aid consistent with the UN Security Council resolution that was passed in February 2014, would be a very, very good idea. And Hillary also has the ability to stand up to Russia in a way that this ticket does not. Donald Trump again and again has praised Vladimir Putin, and it's clear that he has business dealings with Russian oligarchs who are very connected to Putin. The Trump campaign management team had to be fired a month or so ago because of those shadowy connections with pro-Putin forces. Governor Pence made the odd claim. He said, inarguably, Vladimir Putin is a better leader than President Obama. Vladimir Putin's run his economy into the ground. He persecutes LGBT folks and journalists. If you don't know the difference between dictatorship and leadership, then you got to go back to a fifth grade civics class. I tell you what offends me. Governor Pence just said that Donald Trump will rebuild the military. No, he won't. Donald Trump is avoiding paying taxes. The New York Times story, and we need to get this, but the New York Times story suggested that he probably didn't pay taxes for about 18 years starting in 1995. Those years included the years of 9/11. So get this. On 9/11, Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump's hometown was attacked by the worst terrorist attack in the history of the United States. Young men and women signed up to serve in the military to fight terrorism. Hillary Clinton went to Washington to get funds to rebuild her city and protect first responders, but Donald Trump was fighting a very different fight. It was a fight to avoid paying taxes so that he wouldn't support the fight against terror. He wouldn't support troops. He wouldn't support. This is important, Elaine. When a guy running for president will not support the troops, not support veterans, not support teachers, that's really important. And I said about Aleppo, we do agree the notion is we have to create a humanitarian zone in northern Syria. It's very important.
Governor Pence, you had mentioned no-fly zone. Where would you propose setting up a safe zone specifically? How would you keep it safe?
Well, first and foremost, Donald Trump supports our troops. Donald Trump supports our veterans.
He won't pay taxes.
Donald Trump has paid all the taxes that he's... Do you not take deductions?
Gentlemen, this
How
is
does that work?
About
you
know, Syria. I'd like yeah, to... I mean,
but, it, but
honestly,
it is about
honestly,
our
Senator,
troops.
Honestly,
it
Senator,
is about our troops.
I understand why
how,
you want to change it. I understand why you want to change
the subject.
I understand why you want to change the subject. And let me be very clear on this Russian thing. The larger question here...
Do you think Donald
policy.
Trump
Gentlemen,
is smart to not pay taxes?
To get to Russia here,
what we're dealing with... Is the, you know, there's an old proverb that says the Russian bear never dies, it just hibernates. And the truth of the matter is the weak and feckless foreign policy of Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama has awakened an aggression in Russia that first appeared a few years ago with their move in Georgia, now their move into Crimea, now their move into the wider Middle East. And all the while, all we do is fold our arms and say we're not having talks anymore. To answer your question, we just need American strength. We need to marshal the resources of our allies in the region, and in the immediate, we need to act and act now to get people out of harm's way.
And exactly how would those safe zones work? How would they remain safe?
The safe zones would have to be, as the senator said, there's already a framework for this that's been recognized by the international community. But the United States of America needs to be prepared to work with our allies in the region to create a route for safe passage, and then to protect people in those areas, including with a no-fly zone. But look, this is very tough stuff. I served on the Foreign Affairs Committee for a decade. I traveled in and out of that region for 10 years. I saw what the American soldier won in Operation Iraqi Freedom, and to see the weak and feckless leadership that Hillary Clinton was the architect of in the foreign policy of the Obama administration.
Let me come back
is
talk
deeply
about,
troubling to me. That will
let
all change
talk about
the day Donald Trump
Governor
becomes president
Pence doesn't
of the United
want to acknowledge,
States.
Elaine. He doesn't want to acknowledge that we stopped the Iranian nuclear weapons program. He doesn't want
you
to
didn't.
Acknowledge that Hillary was part of the team that got bin Laden. He doesn't want to acknowledge that it's a good thing, not a bad thing. That it's a good thing, not a bad thing, that we're down from 175,000 troops deployed overseas to 15,000. But let me tell you what will really make the Middle East dangerous. Donald Trump's idea that more nations should get nuclear weapons, Saudi Arabia, Japan, South Korea. Ronald Reagan said something really interesting about nuclear proliferation back in the 1980s. He said, the problem with nuclear proliferation is that some fool or maniac could trigger a catastrophic event. And I think that's who Governor Pence's running mate is, exactly who President Reagan warned us about.
Senator, that was even beneath you and Hillary Clinton, and that's pretty low.
But do you think we should have more nuclear weapons in the world will make us safer?
Senator, Ronald Reagan also said nuclear war should never be fought because it can never be won. And the United States of America needs to make investments in modernizing our nuclear force for both deterrence
and assurance. But can you defend Donald Trump's claim that more nations should get nuclear
to our allies? But let me go back to this Iran thing. I mean, he keeps saying that they prevented, that Hillary Clinton, who started the deal with the Iranians, prevented Iran from getting a nuclear weapon.
That's what the Israeli head of the Joint Chiefs of Staff is saying right now,
Governor. Well, that's not what Israel thinks.
Gadi Eisenkot, you can go check it.
You wouldn't necessarily know that. I know you boycotted Prime Minister Netanyahu's speech.
No, I visited him in his office.
You boycotted the speech. The point is, what this so-called Iran deal did was essentially guarantee. I mean, when I was in Congress, I fought hard on a bipartisan basis with Republican and Democrat members to move forward the toughest sanctions, literally in the history of the United States against
Iran. And then Hillary used them.
We were bringing them to heel, but the goal was always that we would only lift the sanctions if Iran permanently renounced their nuclear ambitions.
Elaine, let me just mention one.
They have not, Elaine, let me finish a sentence. Mm-hmm. They have not renounced their nuclear ambitions, and when the deal's period runs out, there's no limitation on them obtaining weapons. That
Elaine,
and the fact that they got
$1.7
billion in a ransom payment.
We need to talk about Russia very quickly,
just astonishing
though, Senator,
the American
please.
People.
Six times tonight, I have said to Governor Pence, I can't imagine how you can defend your running mate's position on one issue after the next. And in all six cases, he's refused to defend his running mate's
position. No, don't put words in my mouth.
All right.
But
he is asking everybody to vote for somebody that he cannot defend. And I just think that should be underlined.
All right, gentlemen, let's talk about Russia. This is the topic that has come up.
I'm very happy to defend Donald Trump.
I will give you an opportunity to do that.
I'll take them one at a time.
More nations should get nuclear weapons.
Don't try to defend that. Well, he never said that, Senator.
He has absolutely said it. Saudi Arabia, South Korea, Japan.
Gentlemen, Russia. Russian President Vladimir Putin invaded Ukraine, annexed Crimea, and has provided crucial military support to the Assad regime. What steps, if any, would your administration take to counter these actions, Senator Kaine?
You got to be tough on Russia. So let's start with not praising Vladimir Putin as a great leader. Donald Trump and Mike Pence have said he's a great leader. And Donald Trump has business dealings with Russia that he refuses to disclose. Hillary Clinton has gone toe-to-toe with Russia. She went toe-to-toe with Russia as Secretary of State to do the New START agreement to reduce Russia's nuclear stockpile. She's had the experience doing it. She went toe-to-toe with Russia and lodged protests when they went into Georgia. And we've done the same thing about Ukraine, but more than lodging protests, we've put punishing economic sanctions on Russia that we need to continue. Donald Trump, on the other hand, didn't know that Russia had invaded the Crimea.
Oh, that's nonsense.
He was on a TV show a couple months back, and he said, I'll guarantee you this, Russia's not going into the Ukraine. And he had to be reminded that they had gone into the Crimea 2 years before. Hillary Clinton has gone toe-to-toe with Russia to work out a deal on New START. She got them engaged in a meaningful way to cap Iran's nuclear weapons program, and yet she stood up to them on issues such as Syria and their invasion of Georgia. You've got to have the ability to do that, and Hillary does. On the other hand, in Donald Trump, you have somebody who praises Vladimir Putin all the time. There, America should really wonder about a President Trump who had a campaign manager with ties to Putin, pro-Putin elements in the Ukraine, who had to be fired for that reason. They should wonder, when Donald Trump is sitting down with Vladimir Putin, is it going to be America's bottom line, or is it going to be Donald Trump's bottom line that he's going to be worried about with all of his business dealings? Now, this could be solved if Donald Trump would be willing to release his tax returns, as he told the American public that he would do. And I know he's laughing at this, but every president
What's it got to do with Russia?
Every president since Richard Nixon has done it, and Donald Trump has said, I'm doing business with Russia, the only way the American public will see whether he has
no,
a conflict of interest.
No, he hasn't said that.
Senator,
your
time is up. Governor.
Well, thanks. Just trying to keep up with the insult-driven campaign on the other side of the table.
I'm just saying facts about your running mate.
Yeah.
Well, and I know you can't defend
Senator,
him.
Senator, please, this
I'm
is
happy
Governor's
to defend him, Senator. Don't put words in my mouth that I'm not defending him.
You're not.
I'm happy to defend him. Most of what you said is completely false, and the American people know that.
This I'll run through
this
the list of things where
the
you
days
Senator,
where
please,
you
this
just say
Governor
stuff
Prince
and people believe
minutes.
It. Look, this is the alternative universe of Washington, D.C. versus reality. Hillary Clinton said her number one priority was a reset with Russia. That reset resulted in the invasion of Ukraine. After they'd infiltrated with what are called little green men, Russian soldiers that were dressing up like Ukrainian dissidents, and then they moved all the way into Crimea, took over the Crimean Peninsula. And Donald Trump knew that happened. He basically was saying it's not going to happen again. The truth of the matter is that what you have in the rise of aggressive Russia, which has had increased its influence in Iran, that now because of this deal is on a pathway in the future to obtain a nuclear. The leading state sponsor of terror in the world in Iran now has a closer working relationship with Russia because of Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama's foreign policy. And $150 billion and sanctions all being lifted. And then, of course, Syria. I mean, it really is extraordinary. Syria is imploding. You just asked a very thoughtful question about the disaster in Aleppo. ISIS is headquartered in Raqqa. ISIS from Raqqa has overrun vast areas that at great sacrifice the American soldier won in Operation Iraqi Freedom. And yet, Senator Kaine still sits here, loyal soldier, I get all that. And saying that the foreign policy of Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama somehow made the world more secure. I mean, it really is astonishing
we've
that on
wiped
the day,
out the leader of Al-Qaeda.
On the day that Iran released four American hostages,
nuclear weapons.
We delivered $400 million in cash as a ransom payment for Americans held by the radical mullahs in Tehran.
And
Governor, just today, Mr. Trump said, quote,
shot.
Putin has no respect for Hillary Clinton and no respect for Obama. Why do you think he'll respect a Trump-Pence administration?
Strength. Plain and simple.
Business.
Donald Trump, that's nonsense. Donald Trump
Donald
a strong
Trump's son
leader
says
who is
that the
going
Trump organization.
To lead with American
Please,
strength.
Senator, I'll give you a chance to respond.
We're going to rebuild our military. And let me say this whole Putin thing. Look. America is stronger than Russia. Our economy is 16 times larger than the Russian economy. America's political system is superior to the crony, corrupt capitalist system in Russia in every way. When Donald Trump and I observe that, as I've said, in Syria, in Iran, in Ukraine, that the small and bullying leader of Russia has been stronger on the world stage than this administration, that's stating painful facts. That's not an endorsement of Vladimir Putin. That's an indictment of the weak and feckless leadership
Senator
of
Kaine.
Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama.
Well, this is one where we can just kind of go to the tape on it. But Governor Pence said, inarguably, Vladimir Putin is a better leader than President Obama.
That is absolutely inaccurate.
And I just think a guy
said
who
he's
praises,
a stronger. He's been stronger on the world stage.
No, you said leader. And I'll just say this, Governor.
Well, you just said better.
If you mistake leadership for dictatorship, and you can't tell the difference. A country that's running its economy.
Yeah, here we go. This is the great school thing again. Right. This is great.
If you can't tell the difference, you shouldn't be commander in chief. Yeah. And with Donald Trump's sons say that they have all these business dealings with Russia. Those could be disclosed with tax returns, but they refuse to do them. Americans need to worry about whether Donald Trump will be watching out for America's bottom line or his own bottom line.
Senator Kaine, what went wrong with the Russia reset?
Vladimir Putin. Vladimir Putin is a dictator.
And what would you do differently?
Vladimir Putin is a dictator. He's not a leader. Anybody who thinks otherwise doesn't know Russian history, and they don't know Vladimir Putin. Hillary Clinton knows exactly who this guy is. John McCain said, I look in his eyes and I see KGB, and Hillary kind of has that same feeling. So how do you deal with him? We do have to deal with Russia in a lot of different ways. There are areas where we can cooperate. So it was Hillary Clinton who worked with Russia on the New START treaty to reduce their nuclear weapons stockpile. It was Hillary Clinton that worked with Russia to get them engaged in a community of nations to stop the Iranian nuclear weapons program without firing a shot. She's not going around praising Vladimir Putin as a great guy, but she knows how to sit down at a table and negotiate tough deals. This is a very challenging part of the world, and we ought to have a commander-in-chief who has prepared and done it rather than somebody who goes around praising Vladimir Putin as a great leader.
All right, I'd like to ask now about North Korea, Iran, and the threat of nuclear weapons. Mm-hmm. North Korea recently conducted its fifth and most powerful nuclear test.
Right.
What specific steps would you take to prevent North Korea from developing a nuclear-armed missile capable of reaching the United States? Governor Pence.
Well, first, we need to make a commitment to rebuild our military, including modernizing our nuclear forces. And we also need an effective American diplomacy that will marshal the resources of nations in the Asian Pacific Rim to put pressure on North Korea, on Kim Jong-un, to abandon his nuclear ambitions. It has to remain the policy of the United States of America, the denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula, plain and simple. And when Donald Trump is president of the United States, we're not going to have the kind of posture in the world that has Russia invading Crimea and Ukraine, that has the Chinese building new islands in the South China Sea, that has literally the world, including North Korea, flouting American power. We're going to go back to the days of peace through strength. But I have to tell you that all this talk about tax returns, and I get it, you know, you want to keep bringing that up. It must have
until
played well
in
some focus group. But here, Hillary Clinton and her husband set up a private foundation called the Clinton Foundation. While she was Secretary of State, the Clinton Foundation accepted tens of millions of dollars from foreign governments and foreign donors. Now you all need to know out there, this is basic stuff. Foreign donors and certainly foreign governments cannot participate in the American political process. They cannot make financial contributions. But the Clintons figured out a way to create a foundation where foreign governments and foreign donors could donate millions of dollars. And then we found, thanks to the good work of the Associated Press, that more than half of her private meetings when she was Secretary of State were given to major donors of the Clinton Foundation. When you talk about all these baseless rumors about Russia and the rest, Hillary Clinton, you asked the trustworthy question at the very beginning. The reason
Governor,
the American people don't trust Hillary Clinton is because they are looking at the pay-to-play politics that she operated with the Clinton Foundation through a
Governor,
private
please.
Server while she's
Your
Secretary of State.
Up, Governor.
And they're saying enough is enough.
Senator Kaine.
I'm going to talk about the foundation, then I'll talk about North Korea. So, on the foundation. I am glad to talk about the foundation. The Clinton Foundation is one of the highest rated charities in the world. It provides AIDS drugs to about 11.5 million people. It helps Americans deal with opioid overdoses. It gets higher rankings for its charity than the American Red Cross does. The Clinton Foundation does an awful lot of good work. Hillary Clinton, as Secretary of State, took no action to benefit the foundation. The State Department did an investigation, and they concluded that everything Hillary Clinton did as Secretary of State was completely in the interests of the United States. So the foundation does good work, and Hillary Clinton, as Secretary of State, acted in the interests of the United States. But let's compare this now with the Trump Organization and the Trump Foundation. The Trump Organization is an octopus-like organization with tentacles all over the world, whose conflict of interest could only be known if Donald Trump would release his tax returns. He's refused to do it. His sons have said that the organization has a lot of business dealings in Russia. And remember, the Trump Organization is not a nonprofit. It's putting money into Donald Trump's pockets and into the pockets of his children, whereas the Clinton Foundation is a nonprofit, and no Clinton family member draws any salary.
The Trump Foundation is a nonprofit.
In addition, Donald Trump has a foundation. The foundation was just fined for illegally contributing foundation dollars to a political campaign of a Florida attorney general. They made an illegal contribution, and then they tried to hide it by disguising it as somebody else, and the person they donated to was somebody whose office was charged with investigating Trump University. This is the difference between a foundation that does good work and a Secretary of State who acted in accord with American interests, and somebody who is conflicted in doing work around the world and won't share with the American public what he's doing and what those conflicts are.
Governor, I will give you 30 seconds to respond because I know you want to, but again, I would remind you both this was about North Korea.
Well, thank you. Thank you. The Trump Foundation's a private family foundation. They give virtually every cent in the Trump Foundation to charitable causes.
Political contributions?
Less than 10 cents on the dollar in the Clinton Foundation has gone to charitable causes.
$20,000 portrait of Donald Trump?
Less than 10 cents on the dollar, the Clinton Foundation has gone to charitable causes.
90%.
It has been a platform for the Clintons to travel the world, to have staff. But honestly, Senator, we would know a lot more about it if Hillary Clinton would just turn over the 33,000 emails that she refused to turn over
that
were in her private server. We'd have a much better picture of what the Clinton Foundation was doing.
Senator Kaine, if you had intelligence that North Korea was about to launch a missile, a nuclear-armed missile capable of reaching the United States, would you take preemptive action?
If a president should take action to defend the United States against imminent threat. You have to. The president has to do that. Now, exactly what action? You would have to determine what your intelligence was, how certain you were of that intelligence, but you would have to take action. You asked the question about how do we deal with North Korea. I'm on the Foreign Relations Committee. We just did an extensive sanctions package against North Korea. And interestingly enough, Elaine, the UN followed and did this virtually the same package. Often China will use their veto in the Security Council to veto a package like that. They're starting to get worried about North Korea, too. Yeah. So they actually supported the sanctions package, even though many of the sanctions are against Chinese firms, Chinese financial institutions. So we're working together with China, and we need to. China's another one of those relationships where it's competitive, it's also challenging, and in times like North Korea, we have to be able to cooperate. Hillary understands that very well. She went once famously to China and stood up at a human rights meeting and looked him in the eye and said, women's rights are human rights. They didn't want her to say that, but she did. But she's also worked on a lot of diplomatic and important diplomatic deals with China, and that's what it's going to take. The thing I would worry a little bit about is that Donald Trump owes about $650 million to banks, including the Bank of China. I'm not sure he could stand up so tough to the people who have loaned him money.
All right, I'd like to turn to our next segment now, and in this I'd like to focus on social issues. You have both been open about the role that faith has played in your lives. Can you discuss in detail a time when you struggled to balance your personal faith and a public policy position? Senator Kaine.
Yeah, that's an easy one for me, Elaine. It's an easy one. I'm really fortunate. I grew up in a wonderful household with great Irish Catholic parents. My mom and dad are sitting right here. I was educated by Jesuits at Rockhurst High School in Kansas City, my 40th reunion's in 10 days. And I worked with Jesuit missionaries in Honduras now nearly 35 years ago, and they were the heroes of my life. I try to practice my religion in a very devout way and follow the teachings of my church in my own personal life. But I don't believe in this nation, a First Amendment nation, where we don't raise any religion over the other, and we allow people to worship as they please, that the doctrines of any one religion should be mandated for everyone. For me, the hardest struggle in my faith life was the Catholic Church is against the death penalty, and so am I. But I was governor of a state, and the state law said that there was a death penalty for crimes if the jury determined them to be heinous. And so I had to grapple with that. When I was running for governor, I was attacked pretty strongly because of my position on the death penalty. But I looked the voters of Virginia in the eye and said, look, this is my religion. I'm not going to change my religious practice to get one vote, but I know how to take an oath and uphold the law, and if you elect me, I will uphold the law. And I was elected, and I did. It was very, very difficult to allow executions to go forward, but in circumstances where I didn't feel like there was a case for clemency, I told Virginia voters I would uphold the law, and I did. That was a real struggle, but I think it is really, really important that those of us who have deep faith lives don't feel like we can just substitute our own views for everybody else in society, regardless of their views.
Governor Pence.
Well, it's a wonderful question. And my Christian faith is at the very heart of who I am. I was also raised in a wonderful family of faith. It was church on Sunday morning and grace before dinner. But my Christian faith became real for me when I made a personal decision for Christ when I was a freshman in college. And I've tried to live that out, however imperfectly, every day of my life since. And with my wife at my side, we followed a calling into public service where we've tried to keep faith with the values that we cherish. And with regard to when I struggle, I appreciate and I have a great deal of respect for Senator Kaine's sincere faith. I truly do.
That's shared.
But for me, I would tell you that for me, the sanctity of life proceeds out of the belief that ancient principle that where God says, before you were formed in the womb, I knew you. And so for my first time in public life, I've sought to stand with great compassion for the sanctity of life. The state of Indiana has also sought to make sure that we expand alternatives in healthcare counseling for women, non-abortion alternatives. I'm also very pleased the fact we're well on our way in Indiana to becoming the most pro-adoption state in America. I think if you're going to be pro-life, you should be pro-adoption. But what I can't understand is with Hillary Clinton and now Senator Kaine at her side is to support a practice like partial birth abortion. I mean, to hold to the view, and I know Senator Kaine, you hold pro-life views personally, but the very idea that a child that is almost born into the world could still have their life taken from them is just anathema to me. And I can't conscience about a party that supports that, or that I know you've historically opposed taxpayer funding of abortion, but Hillary Clinton wants to repeal the long-standing provision in the law where we said we wouldn't use taxpayer dollars to fund abortion. So for me, my faith informs my life. I try and spend a little time on my knees every day, but it all for me begins with cherishing the dignity, the worth, the value of every human life.
Elaine, this is a fundamental question, a fundamental question. Hillary and I are both people out of religious backgrounds. Her Methodist church experience was really formative for her as a public servant. But we really feel like you should live fully and with enthusiasm the commands of your faith. But it is not the role of the public servant to mandate that for everybody else. So let's talk about abortion and choice. Let's talk about that. We support Roe versus Wade. We support the constitutional right of American women to consult their own conscience, their own supportive partner, their own minister, but then make their own decision about pregnancy. That's something we trust American women to do that. And we don't think that women should be punished, as Donald Trump said they should, for making the decision to have an abortion. Governor Pence wants to repeal Roe versus Wade. He said he wants to put it on the ash heap of history. And we have some young people in the audience who weren't even born when Roe was decided. This is pretty important. Before Roe versus Wade, states could pass criminal laws to do just that, to punish women if they made the choice to terminate a pregnancy. I think you should live your moral values, but the last thing, the very last thing that government should do is have laws that would punish women who make reproductive choices. And that is the fundamental difference between a Clinton-Cain ticket and a Trump-Pence ticket that wants to punish women who make
choice. It's really not. Donald Trump and I would never support legislation that punished women who made the heartbreaking choice to end a pregnancy.
And why did Donald Trump say that?
We just never would.
Why did he say that?
Well, look, look, he's not a polished politician like you and Hillary Clinton. And so, you know,
things
don't always
come
out exactly the way he means them, but I'm telling you what are the policy of our administration.
Great line from the Gospel of Matthew. From the fullness of the heart, the mouth speaks.
Yeah.
When Donald Trump says women should be punished, or Mexicans are rapists and criminals,
I'm telling
or John McCain's not a hero, he is showing you who he is.
Senator, you whipped out that Mexican thing again.
Can you defend it?
There are criminal aliens in this country, Tim, who have come into this country illegally, who are perpetrating violence and taking
American
lives.
You want to use a big tar brush against Mexicans?
He also said, and many of them are good people. You keep leaving that out of your quote. And if you want me to go there, I'll go there. But there is a choice here, and it is a choice on life. I couldn't be more proud to be standing with Donald Trump, who's standing for the right to life. It's a principle that Senator Cain, and I'm very gentle about this because I really do respect you. It's a principle that you embrace, and I've appreciated the fact that you've supported the Hyde Amendment, which bans the use of taxpayer funding for abortion in the past, but that's not Hillary Clinton's view. People need to understand we can come together as a nation. We can create a culture of life. More and more young people today are embracing life because we know we are we're better for it. We can, like Mother Teresa said at that famous National Prayer Breakfast.
This is important.
Let's welcome the children into our world. There are so many families around the country who can't have children. We could improve adoption so that families that can't have children can adopt
Governor,
more readily those children.
Governor, why don't you trust women to make this choice for themselves? We can encourage people to support life. Of course we can, but why don't you trust women? Why doesn't Donald Trump trust women to make this choice for themselves? That's what we ought to be doing in public life, living our lives of faith or motivation with enthusiasm and excitement, convincing each other, dialoguing with each other about important moral issues of the day.
Because
but on fundamental issues of morality, we should let women make their own decisions.
Because a society can be judged by how it deals with its most vulnerable, the aged, the infirm, the disabled, and the unborn. I believe it with all my heart, and I couldn't be more proud to be standing with a pro-life candidate in Donald Trump.
I do have one final question for you both tonight. It has been a divisive campaign. Senator Cain, if your ticket wins, what specifically are you going to do to unify the country and reassure the people who voted against you?
That's a really important one. That may be the $64,000 question, because it has been a divisive campaign. And again, Hillary's running a campaign about stronger together. And Donald Trump, and this is not directed at this man, except to the extent that he can't defend Donald Trump. Donald Trump has run a campaign that's been about one insult after the next. But we do have to bring the country together. So here's what we'll do. Hillary Clinton was first lady, then senator for 8 years and secretary of state. And I serve in the Senate. And I'm really amazed, Elaine, as I talk to Republican senators, how well they regard and respect Hillary Clinton. She was on the Armed Services Committee. She was on other committees. She worked across the aisle when she was first lady to get the CHIP program passed so that 8 million low-income kids have health insurance in this country, including 150,000 in Indiana. She worked across the aisle after 9/11 to get health benefits for the first responders who bravely went into the towers and into the Pentagon. She worked to get benefits for TRICARE benefits for National Guard members, including Hoosiers and Virginians in the National Guard. She has a track record of working across the aisle to make things happen. And you know, Elaine, I have the same track record. I was a governor of Virginia with two Republican houses. And in the Senate, I have good working relationships across the aisle. Because yeah, I think it's fine to be a Democrat or Republican or independent, but after Election Day, the goal is work together. And Hillary Clinton has a track record of accomplishment across the aisle that will enable her to do just that when we work with the new Congress in January.
Governor, how will you unify the country if you win?
Well, thank you, Elaine, and thanks for a great discussion.
Absolutely.
Tonight. Thank you, Senator. This is a very challenging time in the life of our nation. Weakened America's place in the world after the leadership of Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama on the world stage has been followed by an economy that is truly struggling, stifled by an avalanche of more taxes, more regulation, Obamacare, the war on coal, and the kind of trade deals that have put American workers in the back seat. And I think the best way that we can bring people together is through change in Washington, D.C. You know, I served in Washington, D.C. for 12 years in the Congress of the United States. And I served with many Republicans and Democrats, men and women of goodwill. The potential is there to really change the direction of this country, but it's going to take leadership to do it. The American people want to see our nation standing tall on the world stage again. They want to see us supporting our military, rebuilding our military, commanding the respect of the world, and they want to see the American economy off to the races again. They want to see an American comeback. And Donald Trump's entire career has been about building. It's been about, it's going through hardship just like a business person does and finding a way through smarts and ingenuity and resilience to fight forward. And when Donald Trump becomes president of the United States, we're going to have a stronger America. When you hear him say he wants to make America great again, when we do that, I truly do believe the American people are going to be standing taller. They're going to see that real change can happen after decades of just talking about it. And when that happens, the American people are going to stand tall, stand together, and we'll have the kind of unity that's been missing for way too long.
All right, gentlemen, thank you so much. This concludes the vice presidential debate. My thanks to the candidates, the commission, and to you for watching. Please tune in this Sunday for the second presidential debate at Washington University in St. Louis and the final debate on October 19th at the University of Nevada, Las Vegas. From Farmville, Virginia, I'm Elaine Quijano of CBS News. Good night.
And that does wrap up the vice presidential debate between Tim Kaine and Mike Pence. Joining me here in our PBS NewsHour studio for some analysis are syndicated columnist Mark Shields, Amy Walter of the Cook Political Report, and Washington Post columnist Michael Gerson. To all three of you, we're going to continue to watch Mr. Pence, Governor Pence, and Senator Kaine on the stage as they greet their family. But Mark Shields, this was a debate with a lot of issue questions. What did you think?
I thought that the Republicans in both weeks, if there were sprints of 20 minutes, did pretty well. Unfortunately, they're 90-minute marathons. Tim Kaine came out caffeinated and a little hyper. As it went on, he got stronger, more measured, and dominated the debate in terms of putting Mike Pence, whose tone throughout I thought was excellent, but putting him on the defensive. And he said, I don't believe you'll defend Donald Trump, and then did the litany. Everything he said about Donald Trump was true. And he was right. Mike Pence did not defend him. He made the best case he could. I thought Pence made a good affirmative case, but he was put on the defensive in trying to defend Trump, which he refused to do.
Amy Walter, did you see Tim Kaine putting Governor Pence on the defensive?
I think that we're going to have to figure out, as people start to digest this, what folks are going to remember more about this debate, whether it was Kaine interrupting to put him on the defensive, which, if you just judge by Twitter and people sort of keying in, they found that a little over the top, right? Just too much time interrupting, not enough time kind of talking about the issues in a more measured way. It is true, though, that while Kaine definitely threw all of Trump's past statements at Pence, he found a way to duck and dodge and try to get the conversation back to Hillary Clinton, back to the issues he wanted to talk about. Are voters going to, as Mark said, see that and go, look, he didn't actually address those specific issues? Or will they remember it more for the fact that we didn't hear Mike Pence go sort of down a rabbit hole in the same way that Donald Trump did in the last debate, where he just defended over-the-top statements and then got himself in bigger trouble?
How do you see it, Michael Gerson?
I think that Senator Kaine often got the best of the arguments. He had this rat-a-tat delivery, like a prepared prosecutor. Mm-hmm. And he had a lot of material to work with, to be honest, I think, with Trump's past statements. Everyone that loves Tim Kaine, who knows him. I'm not sure that was on display tonight here in the debate. He was sometimes not very appealing, particularly in the first half of the debate where I think he interrupted. So I would think by points, you do Kaine, and then by style, it was often Pence.
You're saying that you thought Kaine was too much on the attack, too much trying to pin down Mike Pence.
Yeah, I think caffeinated was maybe too kind in this case. He sometimes seemed rude, and that I think in a debate can come across poorly. But he did get better over time.
All right, our Lisa Desjardins, as we continue to watch the candidates there on the stage at Longwood University, our Lisa Desjardins is somewhere behind the stage or nearby where she's been watching the debate. Lisa, so tell us what you're seeing and hearing there.
That's right, nearby the stage in sort of the next building. This is the spin room where we hear from the campaigns immediately after debate. And I was fortunate that a few feet away from me, who came through the curtain but Kellyanne Conway, the campaign manager for Donald Trump. I was the first to speak with her, and I don't think she's spoken to many reporters at this point. Here's what the Trump campaign told me, what Kellyanne Conway said. She said this was vintage Pence. She felt he knocked it out of the park, that he was particularly commanding on policy. And here's especially what she said, folks. She said she felt he was polite and was never rude, and she feels that Tim Kaine will regret the number of times he interrupted tonight. Now, on the other hand, standing behind me, see this giant scrum of reporters and microphones. They're all in that pile of people talking to Robbie Mook with the Clinton campaign. And I can hear standing, I'm close enough to hear what he's saying. He's stressing other things. He's saying that he felt that Tim Kaine had a strong night on a couple of areas, one of them being talking about women, talking about their appeal to women, and also talking about Donald Trump's history of verbal attacks, as they're calling it, on women and on immigrants. So you have two very different takes on this debate tonight, not hearing about the interruptions from the Kaine camp, but that seems like something the Trump folks are going to stress, probably not just tonight.
All right, Lisa, and we may well be coming back to you a little bit later as you get a chance to talk to some of the other representatives of the two campaigns there. I think we want to go up to our newsroom right now. Is that right? Our John Yang has also been listening very closely to the debate with our team. He's been working with our team, fact-checking what was said tonight. John, what did you discover?
Well, Judy, we found a couple of instances when each of the candidates had a little trouble with the facts. In the one hand, it was Tim Kaine when he was praising the top of his ticket, Hillary Clinton. He gave her credit for a tough negotiation to eliminate the Iranian nuclear weapons program. In fact, that agreement came 2.5 years after Secretary Clinton left the administration, and that the agreement itself slows the nuclear weapon program in Iran, doesn't eliminate it. And Mike Pence also got into a little trouble when he was talking about the top of his ticket, Donald Trump, but it came in defending Mr. Trump when against the allegation or Tim Kaine saying that Trump had said that more nations should get nuclear weapons. Pence came back. He never said Senator, and you know it. In fact, in March, Trump told the New York Times that it may not be such a bad thing for the United States if Japan, South Korea, and Saudi Arabia had nuclear weapons. So in each instance, the top of the ticket got the number two on the ticket into a little trouble, in one case praising and in one case defending. Judy?
Thank you, John. And we know there was a lot thrown around in the debate tonight. There were a lot of issues that they covered. But before we get to any more of that, Mark, I want to come back to you on the points that Amy and Michael were making a minute ago about where Tim Kaine may have won on points, but when it comes to presentation, to demeanor, maybe he didn't. How do you see that?
No, I thought, as I said, I used the word caffeinated. I thought he was quick. He had canned lines, prepared lines, like, you're hired president, you're fired president. He appeared, to use a word, overprepared. I mean, there's no doubt about it. But I think as it went on, I mean, there was no question. He was prosecuting in a more affable sense, but he was making the case. I mean, when he said Governor Pence had to give Donald Trump his tax returns in order to be chosen as vice president, it was a superb point. And Pence, you know, he'd say, I don't think the Senator Pence will defend, Governor Pence will defend this. And he was right. I mean, Pence did not spend his time going down a rabbit hole, as Amy put it, or defending Donald Trump. And I guess when Mike Pence said, Donald Trump used the tax code just the way it was supposed to be used, brilliantly. I have to be very frank. Show us the tax returns. I mean, how brilliant was it? I mean, if you want to do it. And the point that was made that I think will come out of this debate is the narrative. I think the Clinton campaign has mishandled Trump's taxes. And it should be that he says he's smart. And Tim Kaine made the point that means that the people who pay the taxes, whether they're firefighters or emergency room nurses or E5s in the Marine Corps, they're dumb. The people who pay for special education teachers or pay for cops and firefighters, they're dumb. And I think that's the way to separate Donald Trump from his constituency. And I thought that was well done. But there's no question he was yippy and yappy. Like a little puppy at the outset.
Amy Walter, on this tax point, was Tim Kaine right to bring it up again and again and again, or are we just tired of hearing about it?
No, Tim Kaine's job was pretty simple. It was to remind the viewers at every moment things that Trump has said and done that are very difficult to defend, and as we discussed, Pence had a very difficult time and sometimes completely avoided answering those questions. Mike Pence's job was not only to deflect those, but then to try to bring it back. You saw him like try to shoehorn in the email server in an unrelated question. Oh, I got to make sure I get that in. Make sure you got in the Clinton Foundation.
Right.
Make sure you shoehorn that in. But what Pence also did through at the very beginning, he tried to do it again at the end and tried to get it in there at other points. This is about strength. This is about putting America back on track, right? This message of change, things aren't going well. If you want continuity of the bad things that are happening now, then go ahead and vote for Hillary Clinton. If you want to go change and you want strength, come with us. But that was hard to do when it was a constant barrage of Trump statements that he had to defend against.
But isn't that what, I mean, to play devil's advocate here, Michael, isn't that what the Clinton campaign needs to do? I mean, to keep reminding people of what Donald Trump has said.
Yes, and on a number of issues, I think it worked. Governor Pence had a habit of saying reassuring things about that he clearly believes on Russia or Syria or a lot of other topics. It's not clear that Donald Trump actually believed those things.
Right.
I mean, he essentially had to defend Donald Trump by having a different Donald Trump, you know, essentially saying that this is not the man you see, but you can go to the record. And ultimately he could not defend on those issues having to do with civility and cruelty and the treatment of women and all of these issues that Kaine came back to again and again. There is no response. There can't be a response. He has not apologized for those things, and so you can't respond.
Well, you tried to deflect it, right? Well, you're running the insult-driven campaign.
Yeah.
You were the insult-driven campaign, and that was his only...
And then pivot.
Right.
And at one point, he simply said nothing, and just it just went back
to
the questioner.
After the litany he went through, and he didn't say anything, and it was the one point where I thought wanted the moderator to insert herself and say, do you have an answer for that?
All right, we've got Lisa Desjardins. We're going to go back to Farmville, Virginia, to Longwood University. Lisa, you've been talking to some more campaign representatives.
That's right. And I think, Judy, this theme of a real flip in the execution of tone is what we see happening. I just spoke with Virginia Senator Mark Warner. Of course, he used to be the governor of this fine state. And when he was governor, his lieutenant governor was Tim Kaine. Few people know Tim Kaine better. And I asked Governor Warner, I said, what about this accusation that Tim Kaine interrupted too often, that perhaps he was rude? Mark Warner said, if anything, I would never imagine calling Tim Kaine rude. Perhaps there was some back and forth. And I said, no, I counted interruptions. And he did interrupt frequently, and Governor Pence did as well. And he said, no, I think this is from the Democratic viewpoint. They say what Senator Kaine was trying to do was to get Governor Pence to answer for the Trump campaign. And I think we'll hear Democrats say that the Pence-Trump campaign did not answer the accusations made tonight. On the other hand, I talked to Alabama Republican Senator Jeff Sessions, who says they felt that the tone from Governor Pence showed he is a higher-level player than we saw from the Clinton campaign tonight and from Senator Kaine. But moreover, he was talking about depth of policy from Governor Pence. We did see some serious policy discussions tonight, and it's interesting that we hear the Trump campaign in particular pointing that out and feeling that they made some inroads there. Obviously, that's for viewers to decide, but it's something that the Trump campaign is crowing about right now.
All right, Lisa, talking to representative of the campaigns there at the debate side at Longwood University. Amy, you know, this is the point in the discussion when we get to, okay, how much difference is all this going to make in the course, the trajectory of this campaign, whatever these two gentlemen did?
Well, we've spent a whole lot of time talking about tone and interrupting, and we have to also recognize that for most Americans, what they're going to see of this debate is going to come in 30-second clips that the morning shows are going to show or other programs like You Will show tomorrow night. And so if it is, as Mark pointed out, the rat-a-tat-tat of the you said this, you said, you know, or Donald Trump said this, 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 the Mount Rushmore, he supports the Mount Rushmore of these terrible people like Putin and Kim Jong-un, well, then that's a victory for the Clinton campaign, despite the fact that for people who watched it for 90 minutes, it did not feel it felt very different from that. So that's going to really be the true test about whether this mattered or whether Mike Pence and the Trump campaign can make the case that, you know, Pence was the measured one, Kaine was the one that was sort of spiraling out of control, Pence was the one who can handle being under fire.
Michael Gerson, how do you see this question of how much do you see the campaign taking a different course as a result of how well either Tim Kaine or Mike Pence did tonight?
Well, as I said earlier, Republicans were looking for some kind of morale boost, and they may have gotten some tonight. I mean, you know, Mike Pence was calm. He, you know, made the best defense that he could, pushed back hard in certain areas. And so Republicans are going to take some hope from that, given the horrible week that they've had, okay, you know, miserable week they've had. If Democrats will take some hope from the fact that this case was prosecuted again and again and again, and there was not an adequate response on a number of issues. So I'm not sure how much difference that makes, but I think both parties will probably find some way to praise this performance.
Republicans take some heart, Mark.
Sure.
Democrats are pleased that Tim Kaine prosecuted the case.
Republicans will say that Mike Pence, and legitimately so, was unflappable. They in no way, they started to use the similar strategy that Hillary Clinton did last week to get under his skin. Yeah. They did not get under Mike Pence's skin.
Right.
But the problem is that some Republican will say, gee, if only the ticket were reversed, and that will not sit well with the top of the ticket. If that is said anywhere and attributed to any Republican, that, if Pence did a much better job than Trump, it will not please the presidential nominee on the Republican side.
Of course.
The only other thing was there was a little hyperbole, I thought, on the part of Kaine. He was a little bit too fawning, appreciative of Hillary Clinton. I mean, there was sort of a portrait of Hillary Clinton that he gave as the appreciative running mate that I thought was excessive at times. It seemed almost like...
And perhaps defending a status quo on the economy. is not necessarily the best strategy. There could have been more empathy with the concerns that a significant portion of the American public felt. It sounded like a defense of Barack Obama sometimes, not just a defense of Hillary Clinton. And that's really not the purpose here.
But it's interesting, Mark, you say he was too effusive in his praise of Hillary Clinton.
Yes.
I mean, Mike Pence was sitting there saying, I'm very proud to serve with Donald Trump.
That's right.
He ticked off all the reasons why.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering how you strike a balance and you're not that excited about your running.
I felt that there was a canned, it was almost like the Clinton people had prepared Tim Kaine. And these are the points you want to make about how wonderful the nominee is. I felt that at early. And as I say, when he got his footing, I just thought there was no question over the last two-thirds of the debate who was the alpha male in the room, to put it bluntly. I mean, he was dominant, and Mike Pence, who was cool and calm, was reacting and playing defense, and you can't score in defense in these.
Sometimes, Amy, only got a couple of minutes left, but people spend time after these debates saying, well, were they targeting their base, or were they trying to expand the base?
Right.
How did you see that?
Vice presidential debates are always base organized debates. First of all, those are the people who are watching these debates. They're not as they don't bring in as many new voters or new viewers. So that's what this was about. And I agree completely with Michael that it is about reassuring and energizing the people that you need to get to turn out to vote. But all of this, of course, will be soon forgotten. And when we come back here on Sunday and the two main contenders shape up against each other. And so this is probably a very short-lived bounce, whatever it is, for either campaign.
So quick takeaway, Michael?
One thing that was different from the presidential debate was the talk about faith and the way it informs policy. Yep. And this showed the diversity of the Roman Catholic Church. Let's, you know, how broad this is. Mm-hmm. It went all the way from a social justice Catholicism that was very pro-choice in certain ways, all the way to Pence's kind of evangelical Catholicism that talked about, you know, pro-life issues. And they both made their case, and but that was a deepening of an argument.
Two men who grew up in the Catholic faith. Final takeaway.
That's right. The point is that these were supposed to be the nice guys.
That's right.
It was a pretty much of a Pier 6 brawl for two nice guys.
That's exactly right.
Who were brought up as, I think they were both altar boys.
Was Mike Pence an altar boy?
I'm not sure.
He went away to college and lost his faith.
Mark Shields.
Lost his political roots.
Michael
Gerson.
And Amy Walter. And that wraps up our coverage of this vice presidential debate. But there's a whole lot more online where you can watch highlights. That's at pbs.org/newshour. Plus, our politics team of Lisa Desjardins and Dan Bush will be taking your questions live on Facebook. That's in a few minutes, and that's at facebook.com/newshour. I'm Judy Woodruff. Thank you for joining us, and we want you to join us right here for the NewsHour tomorrow evening. For all of us at the PBS NewsHour, we thank you, and good night.
Funding for this PBS election special is provided by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting and viewers like you. Thank you.
Election 2016 on PBS.
The forces of nature keep Earth on the move. Its rotation shapes our lives.
That's amazing. You can't beat that.
Drives the weather and the biology of the creatures that inhabit it. Journey through space to understand motion.
Tomorrow at 8, 7 Central.